Good morning, students. Here we come up with the gross anatomy of the knee joint. Now, our topic is introduction, in which there will be articulating bones. So, in the introduction of the knee joint, articulating bones, we are going to start straight away with the definition of the knee joint. In the definition of the knee joint, it is a compound and complex synovial joint. This is very important, compound and complex synovial joint. Second, first let me note down, it is a compound and complex variety of synovial joint. This statement is very important. Second will be, it is basically a combination of three joint cavities. And these three joint cavities will be the femoropatellar joint cavity between femur and patella, and the two condylar joint cavities, the lateral and medial condyles of the femur with the lateral and medial condyles of the tibia respectively. So, they are the condylar cavities. And these condylar cavities are, as I told you, two, medial and lateral. So, altogether, femoropatellar, one joint cavity, femoropatellar. Second, the two condylar cavities, right and left, between the right and left condyles, that is medial and lateral condyles of the femur. Medial and lateral condyles of femur with medial and lateral condyles of tibia. So basically, one knee joint comprises of three joint cavities, three primitive joint cavities. These three primitive joint cavities, they form together one knee joint. These points should be very clear. Now, coming on to the third point. Third point is, this knee joint is completely, it is a modified variety of hinge joint. Basically, it is a condylar. It is a condylar joint. So, it is condylar variety of synovial joint. Basically, the basic statement, the basic definition, it is a condylar variety of synovial joint, knee joint. But it is also known as modified hinge variety of synovial joint. This is very important. One mark question answer. It is basically also known as modified hinge variety of synovial joint. So basically, it is condylar variety of synovial joint, but it is also known as modified hinge variety of synovial joint. Now, why this knee joint is called modified hinge variety of synovial joint? Because of two reasons. Those two reasons, please note down, one mark question answer. Those two reasons will be, the first reason why it is called modified hinge variety of synovial joint, knee joint. The first reason will be, transverse axis on which the flexion and extension takes place is not fixed. So therefore, during the extension of knee joint, when you extend the knee joint, the transverse axis will move forwards. And when you flex the knee joint, the transverse axis will move backwards. That is one reason why it is called modified hinge variety of synovial joint. Second reason why it is called modified hinge variety of synovial joint will be, there will be little bit of rotation of femur on the tibia during the movements of flexion and extension. And this type of rotation is known as conjunct rotation. It is called conjunct rotation. So therefore, because of this transverse axis which is moving forward and backward during extension and flexion, and because of this conjunct rotational movement of femur on tibia during flexion and extension movements of knee joint, because of these two reasons, it is known as modified hinge variety of synovial joint. So this four points will comprise the introduction. Now we are going to draw the line diagram. Please draw over here. Now this line diagram basically is very simple. This is intercondylar notch, and here we are showing, this is the femur. Now here in this femur, we are going to show, for example, here we separate this, also over here we show in this way. Why this separation we have done is, this surface, the two condyles, for example, if I write here medial condyle of femur, this will be lateral condyle of the femur. Similarly, these surfaces, they are known as tibial articular surface. So it is also called the tibial articular surface, tibial articular surface. The surface which is located here, where my hand is there, that is patellar articular surface. So here I will name this as patellar articular surface. Now this diagram we have drawn in flexed condition. Remember that this is the knee joint which is in flexed condition. There is flexion of the knee joint. So therefore here we are going to draw it in this way. So the knee joint is flexed after the removal of quadriceps femoris muscle and after the removal of patella and ligamentum patelli. And the view is from the front, from anterior, flexed knee joint. Remember, femur is flexed. So therefore, both the surfaces of the femur we are able to see, patellar articular surface as well as the tibial articular surface. Lower down, we are going to draw here. Now, this diagram is for the tibia. So lower down, we are drawing this portion. And here, this is the portion of tibia which we have drawn. So therefore, this is tibia. Here I will write down the tibia. And just on its lateral side, I am going to draw this structure and this will be the fibula. So tibiofibular joint, superior tibiofibular joint. We are interested in the flexed portion of the femur. So therefore here, after marking this, we are going to show the menisci. So in the menisci, here in the menisci, what we are going to show will be this portion which is continuous, and we will darken it, and here we will show this as the menisci. Just below the menisci, as we are showing this as the menisci, just below the menisci we are going to show the coronary ligament. All these ligaments will be clear, but this is just for the sake of diagram which we are drawing. So therefore this we are going to show it as the coronary ligament here. So menisci and the coronary ligaments, this is just for the introduction as it is. And we are going to show here the projecting portion on the lateral condyle. So this is lateral epicondyle, and on the lateral epicondyle we are going to show one ligament which is which is known as fibular collateral ligament. Fibular collateral ligament. Similarly, here there is another projecting portion which is known as medial epicondyle on this side, medial epicondyle, and we are going to show another projecting ligament which will be known as the tibial collateral ligament. Now, after completing this, we are going to mark here, these are the menisci, they are the semilunar cartilages. Here, this will form the coronary ligaments. Ligaments will be discussed in detail in the next phase. So this is just to show the articulating surfaces, how they are. Now, in the articulating bones, what are the articulating surfaces of the bones? As I already told you that it is basically combination of three primitive cavities, femoropateral and medial and lateral condylar joint cavities. Now, femoropatellar, that means there is a saddle variety of synovial joint which will be present between the articular surface of patella, the posterior articular surface of patella, and the anterior patellar articular surface of the femur. So therefore, that is femoropatellar joint. Similarly, the two condylar varieties, the medial and lateral condyle, the medial condyle and lateral condyle of femur will articulate with the medial and lateral condyle of tibia. But they are separated by the semilunar cartilages. And just below the semilunar cartilages, there will be coronary ligaments, which we are going to discuss in detail during the discussion of ligaments. So this is an introduction that the two condyles of femur are separated from the two condyles of tibia. These two condylar varieties are separated by these semilunar cartilages, that is the menisci. Please note down. Now we come to the anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments. How the joint cavity is divided. We know that the condyles of femur and condyles of tibia are separated by the semilunar cartilages and the coronary ligament. Now, individually, the medial condyle and lateral condyle of femur, both of them are separated by sagittal septum. That sagittal septum is called intercondylar septum. And why it is called intercondylar septum? Because this portion, where my finger is there, this portion here is known as intercondylar notch. So I can name this as intercondylar notch. So please note down, this is the intercondylar notch, which is present on the femur in between the two condyles of the femur. Now, attached to this intercondylar notch is a sagittal septum, which is called intercondylar septum. In order to draw that, please come on this side here. I am drawing, this is the sagittal section, so therefore this is the femur sagittal section. Over here, I am going to draw, this will be the tibia. This is in sagittal section. Over here, I am going to draw, this will be the patella, and here I am going to complete this as ligamentum patelli. This is the ligamentum patelli, and therefore what I am going to show over here will be the intercondylar septum. So if this is a sagittal section, it is a schematic diagram. Please draw, it is a schematic diagram, sagittal section. Now here the intercondylar septum, this is how the intercondylar septum is present between the femur and tibia. This is the intercondylar septum. Now, this intercondylar septum is present between the femur and tibia, oriented in a sagittal plane, in the median plane, sagittal plane, attached about to intercondylar notch. Now, this intercondylar septum will separate right and left, that is medial condyle and lateral condyle. So it will separate the medial condylar cavity from lateral condylar cavity. Present in this intercondylar septum is a foramen, and that foramen will be known as intercondylar foramen. So here, this will be the intercondylar foramen. As this intercondylar foramen is present, it will divide the intercondylar septum into two parts, anterior, posterior. The anterior part here, this anterior part, this triangular anterior part which I have drawn with the apex towards the intercondylar notch, this anterior part of the septum will form. What does it form? So here I will color this. It will form the infrapatellar synovial fold. So this will be known as infrapatellar synovial fold. So here I am going to draw infrapatellar synovial fold. I am going to write down this infrapatellar synovial fold. So basically this infrapatellar synovial fold, apex of this is attached to intercondylar notch, and it is basically the anterior segment of intercondylar septum. And why this anterior segment? Because of the formation of intercondylar foramen. So here I am going to mark this as intercondylar foramen. This is intercondylar foramen. And I am going to mark this as the intercondylar septum. So therefore in this diagram, intercondylar septum, there will be formation of intercondylar foramen, which will divide the intercondylar septum into two divisions, anterior segment, posterior segment. Anterior segment will form infrapatellar synovial fold, apex of which is attached to intercondylar notch. Posterior segment here, it will lead to the development of anterior cruciate ligament and posterior cruciate ligament. So later on, this portion will develop into anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments. Both of them will be attached to intercondylar notch. But to which extent they will be attached, that is what we are going to show in the next diagram. So here, this should be very clear, intercondylar septum is basically present in the mid-sagittal plane, separating the medial and lateral condylar joint cavities, in which there is formation of intercondylar foramen, which will divide the intercondylar septum into anteriorly infrapatellar synovial fold, and posteriorly, this will develop into anterior posterior cruciate ligaments. Now we come to this side. Here, in the last, we are going to discuss condyles of femur. The condyles of femur, as you can see, median and lateral condyle, will have two articular surfaces. The anterior articular surface, this is the anterior, will articulate with patella to form femoropatellar synovial joint. And this femoropatellar variety of joint is saddle variety. And anterior margin or the anterior surface of the femur, the femoral condyle, will form the patellar articulation. So therefore, the anterior surface of the condyles of femur will form patellar articular surface. Anterior surface will form the patellar articular surface, anterior surface of condyles of femur. Similarly, the inferior surface and posterior surface of the femoral condyles, inferior and posterior surface of femoral condyles will form tibial articular surface, because they will articulate with tibia, with the condyles of tibia, medial and lateral condyles of tibia. So note down, in the femoral condyles, three surfaces are there: anterior, inferior, posterior. Anterior surface is called patellar articular surface, and the inferior and posterior surface of the femoral condyles is called tibial articular surface. And now in the last, intercondylar notch. What are the structures attached on intercondylar notch? This is very important. It may be a Viva question, one more question answer, MCQ, etc. But you have to mention here in the introduction. In the intercondylar notch, this is the intercondylar notch, there are various structures which are attached. The first structure which is attached on the intercondylar notch will be, here I will mark it with red color. On the, remember this is medial condyle lateral, so on the lateral side of the intercondylar notch, on the posterior superior margin, on the lateral side, on posterior superior margin, there will be attachment of upper end of anterior cruciate ligament. So I am going to draw this. This is the anterior cruciate ligament. Anterior cruciate ligament. So intercondylar notch, here on this space I am going to write down intercondylar notch. What are the structures attached? The first structure will be anterior cruciate ligament. Where is it attached? That is very important. It is attached on the lateral margin of intercondylar notch. Lateral margin of intercondylar notch, where posterior superiorly, anterior cruciate ligament. Which portion of anterior cruciate ligament? Upper part, because lower part is attached to the tibia. That we'll see later on. Second structure that will be attached to intercondylar notch will be the posterior cruciate ligament. Now, posterior cruciate ligament, where is it attached? On the medial part of intercondylar notch. Now, where in the medial part of intercondylar notch? Antero-inferior margin. On the medial part of intercondylar notch, antero-inferiorly. Remember it this way. And this will be the posterior cruciate ligament. So, two structures. One is anterior cruciate ligament on the lateral margin of intercondylar notch, posterior superiorly. Second is the posterior cruciate ligament, upper part of posterior cruciate ligament, where anterior inferiorly. But which part? On the medial part of intercondylar notch. Third structure. Now, third structure that is attached will be at the lower margin, at the tip, lower margin of intercondylar notch, there is attachment of the infrapatellar synovial fold. Please note down. And that infrapatellar synovial fold is what we have drawn here. The apex of infrapatellar synovial fold, which is attached to the intercondylar notch. So at the lower margin of intercondylar notch, apex of infrapatellar synovial fold. This is the third structure. Then fourth structure that is attached will be capsule. The capsule of the knee joint which is attached. And the fifth structure that will be attached is oblique popliteal ligament. Please note down, these are the five structures which are attached on intercondylar notch. Anterior cruciate ligament, posterior cruciate ligament, apex of the infrapatellar synovial fold, then the capsular ligament and oblique popliteal ligament. So here we end our part 1 of the introduction, articulating surfaces. In the part 2, we are going to discuss the articulating surfaces of the tibia. Thank you very much.